to overflow with lectures. So I'll try to keep this pace, but if you feel we can sort of speed up, let me know and I can upload more videos and we can discuss more videos, more lectures, sorry. Yes, the other thing I wanted to say is I think Slack is a very good tool which can be used a little bit more and can be very effective if you have questions that are related to like calculations or simple questions that can be easily answered like just writing. So please post questions on the on the Slack channel of the lectures if you have. Yes, that's the only thing I wanted. The last thing is I think I'll upload probably tomorrow the first set of assignments. You can, as I said, you can work on that with others. So I know that the situation in terms of your location is a little bit variable, but please try to, please, you can work with others, and I think it's a good strategy. It's effective. I'll upload assignments that will cover the whole part of ecology, and the deadline is going to be quite away in the future, so in probably 1 month. But you will be able to see all the exercise for ecology that you have to solve. Then there will be other assignments for the evolution part, but this will be the first. Okay? Great. Then I can shut up. If you have questions.
I have a question about the catastrophes.
Okay.
And in particular, when you calculated the point where the two line intersect, when we find it was approximately with U equal to square root of 3. I didn't understand why we calculated the derivative of K and rho with respect to U to calculate this point.
Okay, let me share the screen and I'll try to explain that. Okay, can you see the screen?
Yes.
Okay, so we had two expressions of K and rho as a function of u, which I don't remember. There was a u cube, I think, a 2. And I think here was u cube minus 1 squared, and here 1 plus u, something like this.
Yes.
Yes, I mean, I'm not sure of this expression, but it was something like this. Okay.
Okay.
So what we saw, and we want to sort of draw the implicit function rho and k, right? So the lines defined by this function here. So you see that as u goes to infinity, well, you see one thing. First, you see that you have a divergence for u lower than 1, for u equal to 1. Okay. Now, u is a population, so it can only be positive. So you have a divergence in u equal to 1. Okay. And for u equal to 1, k is going to infinity. So for u that stands to 1, k is going to infinity. And rho is going to, here it's 1, here it's 2 squared. So this is, I think, 1/2. Okay. So it means that when u tends to 1, it's something like this. Okay. And then you have for u that goes to infinity, you are here. Okay.
Okay.
Now, the question is like, of course, you can move from 1 to infinity, and this curve don't have any discontinuity, right? So you expect that some solution exists in between. So let's say that you start from one and you increase, right? You expect that, okay, rho is gonna decrease, rho is gonna increase, and k is gonna decrease. And the same if you move from here, right? So they're probably perhaps they're joining in some point, okay? Now, if they're joining in some point, it means that that point is the minimum and the maximum of k and rho respectively as a function of u. Okay.
Okay. So,
right. So if that is a minimum of k as a function of u, that means that I can look at when this is equal to zero.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And then what I find is that this is square root of three. I mean, this is like when u is equal to square root of three. And I can say, I can also look at when rho is equal to zero, and I find the same value, right? So it means that this point is an extreme for u, for both rho and k. So there will be something like this, okay?
Okay.
Does that answer your question?
Yeah, yeah. But how can we know that this point is, sharp and not...
Yes.
With a continuous derivative?
Good question. So actually, what happens in this point, I haven't discussed it, but it's sort of interesting to see what happens there. Right? So you can approach to this point from two sides, right? You can approach this point as u tends to square root of 3 plus, or u tends to square root of 3 minus, right? So you can approach from this side or this side, okay? So what you can do is that you can say, what is the tangent to these two lines here? The tangent to these two lines is d rho dk, okay? Which is equal to d rho du, okay? So this is the derivative of these lines here, and then I have to evaluate it in the u I'm interested in, right? So if I evaluate it and at this point, I want to evaluate this point here, this will correspond to a value of u which is between 1 and square root of 3, which will be somewhere in the middle, and I get what is the derivative in this point, okay? So what I want to do is, if I want to calculate the derivatives here, I have to calculate the limit for u that goes to square root of 3 plus of d rho dk u. And I have to calculate the limit of the same function as u goes to square root of 3 minus, right? And they correspond to whether I approach from this branch here or I approach from this branch here, okay? Now, note that what happens here is not trivial, right? Because this quantity here tends to zero as u tends to square root of 3, and this quantity here tends to infinity as u tends to square root of 3, because the argument tends to zero, right? So this looks like an indeterminate case, but if you substitute the equations here, you calculate the derivative, and you substitute here, you discover that this approach some finite value c, and these approach the same value c, okay? So they tend to the same limit, which is a finite number. So what that means that so you have something like this. If I zoom here, what happens is that basically the two curves are like this, okay? So they have the same derivatives, which is finite. So the slope is, it's finite, is some value. and they have the same slope, so they start diverging to each other with the second, I mean, with the second order term. Okay, so this is what happens to at this point, this cusp here. But okay, note that the derivative is the same for both the branches, so it's not really like what it looks like here. So this is not this, okay? Because the derivatives here really are the same. Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
Okay. Okay. Good. Any other question?
At which time scale the catastrophe happen in the real world?
So say it again, at which time scale?
At which time scale the jump of the fixed points happened in the real world?
You mean what happens for what time scale for real worms? I mean, I don't know the precise value, but I can sort of guess it, right? So the reproduction time scale of worms is in the order of days. So what happens as you approach the bifurcation point? So let's say that you are, let's say that you are moving like this in this bifurcation point. So you are increasing rho, and this is U star on this line here. So you have something like this. Okay, and so if this is phase one, phase two, phase three, this is one, this is two, this is three. I guess that what you're asking is, let's say that you are like here and you're moving rho, you cross this rho, how much time does it take for the population to relax to this fixed point?
Yes.
Okay, so this time scale here is determined by which parameters? Well, it's determined by the two time scale, which are, so in this model, let's write it in this way, Rn1 minus n over k minus a n squared b squared plus n squared. So there are two time scales, right? A and R have the dimension of a time scale. Okay, so the time it takes to relax to the fixed point depends on what is the typical time scale of these two numbers here. So what is R? Well, R is the growth rate of the population in absence of predators. So for worms, I would expect that this is on the order of days. Okay. And as for the predation, more or less the same, right? So I would expect that the change here to go to the other fixed points is in the order of days, which is the time scale of the population dynamics of the worms. The two parameters that determine how much does it take are this R and A, right? Which somehow we rescaled as we consider this approximation here.
Can we compute exactly the time?
No, we never computed the time.
But we could, or not?
I mean, you cannot compute exactly the time it takes. I mean, first of all, let's look at what will be the trajectory. Let's say that you are like here, you move rho and you jump over there, okay? So you are in U and you are like, in, let's say that you are slightly before this transition. Let's do this. So let's say that I have time and here I have the parameter rho, right? And then I do this and then after a critical, I mean, at some time T star, I move this rho above the bifurcation, okay? So let's say that this value here, it's rho C, and the value rho C is some here in between. Okay, it's clear what I'm doing here?
Yes.
Okay, so I'm just moving this in time. So U star is gonna be here, and then it's gonna go to the new fixed point, which is, I mean, this change is small, okay? It's gonna jump to another fixed point much higher. Okay, what happens is that sorry, you are going to have some dynamics there, which is not, in general, you will not able to describe analytically. And then you are going to relax sort of exponentially to this fixed point. Okay? So what happens here, it's hard to compute. What happens there, it's easy in the sense that if you call this U star 3, actually we used to call this C, right? So this is the fixed point A. So close to this fixed point C, U of T is gonna be something like C minus something which will depend on the initial conditions, and that is not trivial to calculate, e to the minus some parameter t, okay? Because you will relax exponentially to this point. What is this value here? Well, what you have to do is just to compute the linearization close to the fixed point C, okay? And this value here will tell you what is the time scale of the relaxation. The rationale of this is that you can imagine that when you are close enough to this new fixed point, you can expand U close to C, okay? So you can linearize the dynamics close to C and then you get the linearized dynamics. Okay. Is that clear?
Yes, thanks.
But the point is, what happens here is non-trivial. I mean, it depends on the full non-linearities of the dynamics.
Okay.
Nevertheless, how much time does it take here typically? It will be on the order of the time scale of the process, which in this case, with the sort of, it's on the order of R, let's say. Okay.
Okay.
Because, like, basically, what happens here is that you are somehow moving to a new state where predation is not important anymore. And so what determines how much you move to the carrying capacity is basically R. Okay. Does that answer your question or you wanted to?
Yes, thanks.
Okay. So the point is, I mean, this goes back to a question that someone asked last time, how fast this is going to be, right? We are talking about abrupt changes. What does it mean abrupt? Of course, the trajectory is always continuous. You don't create worms from the vacuum. But still, the point is that it's much. It's fast. It's a sort of relatively fast change, right? Fast in the sense that you have a big change in the fixed point, which corresponds to a small change in the parameters, right? Any other question?
Professor, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes. So I have a question about the lecture on linear systems in bigger than one dimension. So I took a linear algebra course a very long time ago because it was in the first year of university. And I have trouble with the notation you used. So for instance, if you have a matrix, of course, you have two indices, I and J, because you have rows and you have columns, right?
Yes.
If you have vectors, I expect one index because, you just list the components, but then
yes,
alpha and beta, yeah. Yes.
Okay. Well, the point is, this is why I introduced this notation here, okay? It's because what I mean with this is that you are looking at the component I of the eigenvector corresponding to lambda alpha, okay?
Ah, okay.
So you have, let's say, the matrix M, and the definition of the eigenvector and eigenvalues is that they are the solution of, they are the solution of this equation, okay?
Okay.
How many you have? Well, these, you have, I mean, different, you have as many eigenvector, eigenvalues as the dimensionality of the system. So alpha goes from one to n, right? Well, mm-hmm. M is a, n times m matrix. Okay, so the point is that you have m, which is like, so this is m, this is n, n, and then you have one vector, which is v alpha. So this mm-hmm. component here is v one alpha.
Okay.
This is v something alpha. This is like v n alpha. Okay. And this is equal to a scalar lambda, the same vector v alpha. Okay.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah. This is just the notation. On the other hand, you can arrange all your eigenvectors in a matrix, right? You have v1, v, v2, vn. Okay. Where this vector here is exactly that vector.
Mm-hmm.
And then you can show that if I call this capital V, okay, let's say that M is symmetric, just because this slightly simplify everything. So I can show you that MV is equal to lambda V, where this is sort of, this follows from this definition, right?
Mm-hmm.
I just sort of wrote this for all the vectors and you get this expression here.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, what the spectral theorem tells you, which is something that is valid if the matrix is real and symmetric, or if the matrix mm-hmm. is Hermitian, is that V transposed V equals to V, V transposed equal to the identity matrix.
Okay.
Okay. Right. Sorry, here it's wrong. Oh, here I should have written. Oof. Here I should have written V lambda, I believe. Oh, no, okay, sorry. It's V transposed, okay? You can check that this corresponds to the right solution here. I mean, technically, this is like a row vector, right?
Okay.
Okay?
Yeah.
So if you plug this definition, you get this. And now using the spectral theorem, you can multiply this is V transpose lambda. Well, it doesn't, oh yeah, okay. And no, there is something I'm doing wrong. What am I doing?
Doesn't needs to be V times M equal to...
well, these are left or right, so it doesn't change. This is symmetric, so it doesn't change.
Oh, okay.
Oh, yes, I know what I did wrong. So you should write, I think, okay. I think it's like this. Okay. And then if you multiply on both sides by V, V transposed, you get, something like this, right? Mm. And so this, by the use of that thing, becomes one, and here you get the linearization, the diagonalization, right? So this matrix diagonalize the matrix, right? Actually, sorry. Then if you multiply on both sides by Vt, you get Vt M V equal to Vt V lambda Vt V, which is equal to lambda. So this matrix here diagonalize the matrix M. Okay? So I hope this clarifies the notation which with what you have seen.
Yes, the, yes, it does.
Okay.
It does, yes.
Yes. I mean, the for the majority of you, probably you are somewhat familiar with what happens for symmetric matrices, because most of the linear algebra you use it for quantum mechanics, where basically you only play with Hermitian matrices. And therefore, it's easy to connect, but probably you will never encounter the term left and right eigenvector, which might have been a little bit confusing at the beginning. Because also in linear algebra courses, typically it's put a lot of emphasis on the spectral theorem, but not to what happens when the matrix is not symmetric. Or where it's not Hermitian. But I mean, sort of for what we need for the class is that small set of facts that I gave you for non-symmetric matrices. Then I encourage you to go back to your favorite linear algebra book and sort of check them again. But yeah. Other questions about the linear algebra part? The linear systems part? Mattia, you are talking, but you are muted. If you are talking with me.
Ah, okay. Yes. I have a question. When we wrote the function C beta of T.
Yes.
Then we derived an expression for C for the derivative of C beta, and we find that C the derivative of C beta is equal to lambda P times C beta.
Yes.
And then we solved this equation, and we said that C beta is equal to C beta zero times A yes. E to the power of lambda BT. But C is a function of the coordinates because it is the sum. So how can we say that this is equal to an exponential?
So the point is that you have this question, it's also related to the symmetric case, right? Not only to the non-symmetric.
Yeah, it was in the symmetric case.
Okay. Yeah, I don't remember. C probably, yes, was in the symmetric. The point is you can write an equation for, let's say, the vector x, okay? So if you want, you have x1 of t, x2 of t, et cetera, et cetera. And you want to write what is this, I mean, you write an equation for this, and you want to find what is the solution, this solution here. Or what you can do is that you can take another vector, let's say c1 of t, et cetera, et cetera, which you define as some matrix v times x1, x2, et cetera. right? So instead of looking at the solution x1, solution x2, solution x3, I looked at several linear combinations of them. Okay? And when I look at several linear combinations of that, I discover that C beta of T is a very simple form. Okay? Now, this is still the linear combination I had before. Now, the reason I can do this is because I have a linear system, so I'm not comparing apples with oranges, right? These are all apples in some sense, all the X, right? They all live in the same space and their equation is X dot is a linear combination of the X, right? Now, the important point here, why, I mean, this is also useful, is that I can invert this, okay? I can invert this because I know that V transposed C is going to be equal to V transposed V X. And so is equal to X, right? So what I'm doing in practice is that you have this system and you are in this high dimensional space and you move in this space in some complicated way. And then what you do is that you rotate this space and you discover that you have some directions that are independent. Okay?
Okay. This is the same when we have some coupled oscillators and then we...
Oh, yes. Yes.
Ah, okay.
Yes. Okay. I mean, is almost the same in the sense that when you have a coupled oscillators, I mean, the tools you use when you have high dimensional, yes, I mean, is the sense in that case you have x dot dot equal to mx, right? Which is a different equation, right?
Yeah, yeah.
I believe there is a minus probably here. Well, up to a redefinition of M, you have this equation, right? Which actually is an equation which is 2n times 2n dimensional, because you can write this as x dot equal, as v dot equal to mv and x dot equal to v, okay? Now you can say, oh, but how can I solve this? Well, you can realize that this is also a linear equation. Okay, this is also a linear equation in now a bigger dimensional space, right? Let me do this right. This is M and this is the identity matrix, right? Right? So these systems you might be used to where there is a second derivative is actually a linear system and the matrix you have is something like this. Okay?
Okay.
So now what you want to do is you want to study the eigenvalues of this matrix, right? And the eigenvector of this matrix. But what are the eigenvalues of this matrix? Well, you can play a little bit around, but you will discover that the eigenvalue of this matrix are the eigenvalues of M. And the reason is that if you write the want to find the eigenvalues, so the eigenvalues are the solution of z m 1, so it's the determinant of right equal to 0. This is the characteristic polynomial. I mean, yes, okay, and the determinant when you have such a block matrix is gonna be the determinant of this block times this block minus this block times this block. So that is the determinant of z squared 1 minus m. Okay? And therefore, the eigenvalues are going to be the solutions of this equation here. Okay? I mean, the eigenvalues of this big matrix are going to be the eigenvalues of this small matrix. Of the square root of the eigenvalues of this small matrix, plus or minus. Okay? So, yes. But you, I mean, what is important, and that was a part of the message, is I mean, you are probably familiar with linear systems. I mean, you certainly are familiar with this. To this equation here, okay, which is a simple oscillator. You have solved it so many times. What I wanted to show you is that this is an example of a much larger class of problems like this, and you can solve all of them in this way, right? And you can sort of understand the solution of these problems in terms of the solution of this more general problem. But also, like, for instance, in the example you highlighted, right, you, in this problem here, you immediately see what you have to solve, right? What you have to, if you want to solve this problem, what you have to know are the eigenvalues and the eigenvectors of this matrix here. Once you know them, you are done, right, with your problem. So if you know the eigenvalues and the eigenvectors, you're going to know all the normal modes of your systems, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Any other question?
No.
Okay. It's interesting that the Zoom session is the one where I have the least number of questions, and the number of questions, it's it's not surprisingly higher when you have in-person things. But anyhow, I don't want to steal your time if you don't have questions. I'll upload a couple of more lectures this week. So the next lecture is going to be about Lotka-Volterra dynamics. So who have seen Lotka-Volterra equations in the past? Raise your hand. I'm just curious. Okay, good. Great. That's a good news. It means I'm not saying something you already know. So we're going to study predator-prey Lotka-Volterra equations and competitive Lotka-Volterra equations that describes the interaction with the species, between species. And these are going to be the first example on nonlinear dynamics. And then the other thing I wanted to do this week is to introduce, to sort of take open a parenthesis and have one lecture on epidemiology when we study simple models of epidemiology. So the SIS model, SIR. Who has seen SIR, SIS model? Mattia? No?
But only in a seminar, so not in a
okay. Great. Yeah, so these are like sort of super simple models of an epidemic spreading through a population, and we are going to introduce some sort of in this simple setting concepts you have probably read from newspapers or Facebook whenever you find your information source, like R naught or herd immunity, and we're going to discuss briefly the role of vaccinations. So these sort of things you have heard and you have seen discussed in these simple models. Then we'll close the parentheses and go back to ecology next week. Okay, good. So thanks a lot. I'll stop recording.